Yes, yes.
Hazur, this question is concerning 12 tribes of Israel which left Palestine at a certain time.
All the 12?
12 tribes.
Did they leave Palestine? All of them?
That's what I'm going to ask you, sir.
10 tribes were expelled from the mainland, that is Judea, within Judea they lived. At various, at different times of history, not all together, all of them.
But there is one.
I mean, in one, for instance, one invasion, some tribes were expelled. At another invasion, some others had to migrate, and due to the difficult conditions, and or due to the vengeance of the ruling, the government, because they attempted a rebellion or were at least alleged to have attempted rebellion. So,
but these 10 tribes, there were 10 tribes who were expelled from Palestine at various times.
Yes, that's right.
Now the point is, were they expelled or did they leave voluntarily?
No, not voluntarily, not at all. In fact, they were the Jews were constantly hoping to have their own government, and they still hope to have a world government. So the Israeli plans are not just for Palestine, that is just a springboard to them. They believe that Hazrat Dawood, David, whom they consider a king and not a prophet, but they revere him very highly, and because he is the one through whom the promises of a worldwide government have reached generations. And it is, the belief of all the Jews that ultimately the house of Israel, through David, because he is the original one whom it was promised, would conquer the entire world. Palestine is just a stepping stone towards that ultimate objective. Now this is so old that ever since the time of Hazrat Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam, or rather from the time of the loss of the great empire after the death of Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, they have been attempting repeatedly to overthrow the government of that province that was under Roman rule, and at least have some foothold in that area. From then on, they could spread to the adjacent countries and enlarge their territory. Now, these attempts failed, and because of that, they were invaded by the central government, at the instance of central government, by nearby rulers who were in fact tributaries of the greater Roman Empire, or through other factors. I mean, different times, different things happen. Anyway, the net result was that they were trampled upon, they were destroyed, annihilated. It was seen that the Temple of Solomon was totally demolished and effaced from earth, and it was defiled. In fact, so much so that at the time of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu conquered that area and visited that place, it was a heap of refuse and filth, the most sacred place. So because of this long history of repeated attempts to capture the government and their subsequent defeats, things were made so hot for them, so intolerable in that area, that those tribes particularly who were involved in one particular rebellion, they either could not live or they were expelled by the government. But they never went out of volition.
I have read that book where about this conspiracy to form a world government. They have used different words. I forgot the name of that book. It's a very good book.
This is the protocol of the elders of Zion.
Yes, that's right.
And the commentary, which is a very useful commentary, and in fact, you can't understand the true import of the book without the help of that commentary. That is written perhaps by a Protestant bishop or something, I don't remember, but any church representative from the Protestant sect. He has made a lot of research on this, and the book he has written is named Waters Flowing Eastwards.
Yes.
I don't know why he has chosen this title, but it was found once in the market under this title. He has not only commented on this small booklet, Elders of Zion, but also he has traced the entire history of the struggle between the Jews and the non-Jewish forces about this book. Throughout, the Jews have been trying to disown it and trying to prove it to be a forgery. On the contrary, at various times, various people, Christians and others, have attempted to prove it to be an authentic book, a true representative book of the Jewish elders. Now, this has sometimes, this issue has been taken to courts. And at such times, it was so organized that when the issue was taken to courts by Jews, the jury happened to be under the full influence of the Jews, and sometimes the judge himself was a Jew. So at one such opportune moment in Switzerland, they took the matter to the court, High Court of Switzerland, or whatever it is called, and they categorically declared that this book is a forgery. It has nothing to do with the Judaism. And it's entirely a concocted thing and has no authenticity. Now, they mentioned, the Jews propagated it all over the world, that this book has been proved to be totally a wrong one. I mean, a false allegation and nothing more. Yet, what they forget to tell about, or I mean, they withhold from the rest of the world, is the fact that an appeal was made against this decision, and the Supreme Court of the same country totally disagreed and quashed the proceedings of the High Court and declared that this book is not a forgery but is a truly authentic work of the Jews. So he also traces other attempts and the Jewish attempts to suppress Jewish attempts to, first of all, create an impression that it is a hollow, hocus-pocus thing, has no substance. Number two, the Jewish attempts to take away the entire books published from the market at whatever cost. All those books which are published on this subject are immediately immediately removed from the market, and they are disappear within a matter of few days. And that author has also researched on this, and he quotes instances where certain attempts were made by non-Jewish people to introduce this book to the public. And when it came to the market, immediately it got disappeared. And investigations showed that some rich Jewish houses bought the entire stock, lock, stock and barrel, and destroyed them. And threats were created on those houses which published these books. Only recently, a book has come out in the market in England. Research has been made on this subject, and the author of that book has disclosed certain very important facts, and he has also authenticated them, and he has given full evidence. He was working on the ways and means of Freemasons. Allegations are made against such Freemasons, and he made full investigations about each investigation. And he seems to be a very, very fair-minded person, because he has given full credit for any possibility of doubt. And whatever he establishes after his argumentation appears to be a very weighty thing, not to be dismissed lightly. Now, he also speaks on the same thing. He says a very strange thing happened when this book was given to publishing house. They were extremely enthusiastic about it, and they decided, and we went into an agreement, and it was about to be published, when unfortunately that publishing house was bought by some other people. How it happened, I don't know, he says. He gave the names and everything. Now, there were two brothers who became the managing board of that publishing house later on, and members of the managing board. And they kept on dilly-dallying and wouldn't offer any reason why the book was not published. So ultimately he lost patience and he went to see them and said, "Look here, I want a very clear answer. We have gone to an agreement, and your press was so, house was so enthusiastic about this book. Why? It's backing out now." So the excuse they offered was simply this, which is of course very lame excuse, but that shows something deeper within. He says, "Unfortunately for you, our father happens to be a Freemason, and we cannot afford to displease him. Whatever costs we have to pay towards this, whatever costs we have to suffer, this will not happen. And this book will not be published by our house." That was final. So it was with great difficulty he ultimately succeeded in having this book published. So this happens even now here, nowadays. I'm talking of just a recent incident. And in the book which we have referred to, Protocol of the Elders of Zion,
yes,
that book claims that the organization which will be known to the public eye, controlled by the elders,
yes,
would be Freemasonry. And people will only know Freemasons, and beyond that there would be 30 tiers, or 29 tiers, altogether 30 tiers. 29 tiers of secret organizations, one above the other, which will be completely unknown to the public. And we will manage to move things through the instrument of Freemasonry. And if something happens, we will exert pressures. Now, this claim is exactly proved right when you study the history of Freemasonry. And the plan of Freemasonry, which has been mentioned there, that also has come true. Also, that book mentions the future shape of the world, what type of the world government would come into being. And in that book, which was first discovered, it was written much earlier, first discovered in 1897 something in Germany, and later on it was smuggled to Russia and first came to light in 1905. It first came to light to the Russians earlier, but the first English version was published in 1905 in England. Now, that book speaks of the United Nations so clearly, as if a prophet is making a prediction which has come true right to the letter. It speaks also of the World Health Organization, of the Children's Fund and things, of the aid program of the United Nations. and how the entire world would be brought under the influence of the United Nations, and that United Nations would ultimately be controlled by jury.
Yes, right.
You know?
Yes.
Now, this author, which I am mentioning, has made all that research, and he also quotes certain very important authorities on this subject, political authorities, their opinion. And as if I remember rightly, I think he quotes Disraeli, that when he was asked about his opinion about this book, Disraeli remarked that either this book is genuine, it's not hocus-pocus at all, it has to be genuine, or it must have been written by a very great prophet of God. Because whatever is mentioned in this book would happen in future is exactly happening like this. So we have no alternative. Either to believe that one hidden prophet of God appeared and wrote this book and disappeared without making himself known and introduced to the world, or this book is genuine. Again, this author has mentioned some attempts in Turkey to suppress this book and to plant a sort of evidence which would mislead the people about the authenticity of the book. And it mentions a very interesting incident that, you know, Turkey at one time has been completely under the sway of Freemasons during the Kemal Atatürk time and onwards. This book says that a research was made by the Jews in Turkey, and it came to light that it was a Turkish someone who in fact wrote this book long before it was discovered to be a document of the jury, and that was published, and they proved it, and they stopped their research at that. This author followed the line up and found that in fact it went beyond. And this is what the Jews suppressed. That author had taken this. He was not an author. He was only a translator of a book which dated back to the time of Marx.
Yes, sir.
And it was published a few years before Marxism came into being. And in that book it is prophesied that we would give the world pseudo-philosophies and break the world into two blocks, Eastern and Western block. And the communist philosophy is discussed there in that book. And also the philosophy of capitalism and the usury and things, and how through the banking system and the war between these two blocks ultimately will control both these big powers. This is what surprised Disraeli, in fact, or some other thinkers of the time, that if this book dates back to time prior to the creation of Marxism, and it speaks so clearly of what is going to happen to the world and how the world would be politically divided into two camps, how could it be a forgery? It has to be a design, a plan, and also a plan by people who know how to execute their plans. Must be a very powerful group behind the author, because it is not the work of an individual author either. So this is a very interesting book. I wonder if it is available in the market, because when it was published, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Salis got hold of a few copies, and he gave me two books, presented to me, I mean, out of gifted two books. And one was meant for Waqf-e Jadid and one for my personal use. So we have those two copies. But I think he also gave a few others, distributed to others. But later on, when we tried to get the book, it had disappeared. So try to contact some publishing house here or some bookshop. And yes, find if you can get hold of this book. This is a much very interesting study.
Yes.
Although you didn't ask all this which I have answered, but I thought it was a subject which would be beneficial for the rest to know. We should also know what is happening, what intrigues are being made against Islam and religion and things, you know. This is an intrigue against all that is good, because that book is a very, very serious threat to the entire world morality. Also in this it is discussed, what you are saying today in newspapers, in magazines, in television and all that, that has been also mentioned in that book, that we will give new trends to the world of debauchery and luxurious life, and we will create new markets for this, so that the entire world wealth is diverted to these so-called sources of pleasure or relaxation or things, and the entire attention of the people would be directed towards sex and sexuality and the concomitant things. And this would give us opportunity to create industries and also to corrupt people's mind so that they don't think beyond their noses, and they don't see beyond their noses in future. They will get so deeply involved. Also through this will corrupt the hierarchy of every government, and will be in a power to blackmail them then. We'll give them new ways of luxury, we'll explode all the taboos imposed by religion on these things. And we'll say, what is wrong with this, what is wrong with this? We'll give them ways of beastly pleasures. And we'll make them so accustomed to these that they'll be sort of addicted to such pleasures. They'll not be able to break away from these chains. And once we have got them, will make the such governments further corrupt, and if they then play to our tunes, they will remain in power. If not, we'll disclose all their secrets, we'll publicize their briberies, their luxuries, their pleasure seeking and things which are going to embarrass them, and they'll be forced to resign. And we'll do the same thing to the next government and so on. So these designs are discussed in such detail, and this is exactly what is happening nowadays in the world. You know what happens to the Japanese ministers who for a time being play to the tune of the CIA, and during that course they are bribed through big houses, financial commercial houses or big aeroplane companies and things, manufacturing companies. And once they fall out of favor, those things which were known to everybody even before, the higher-ups, they were immediately published. And these things are happening everywhere in the world. No government can afford to get out of their clutches, because every government is corrupt. So they have published a program of corrupting the world without corruption. They say a small minority, however powerful it be, cannot rule the world. So it has to be through corruption that you will rule the world, and through these diabolical pleasure seeking, the diabolical modes of seeking pleasure. Now this is something which is very interesting for the Ahmadis. There are two facts which are to be known by every Ahmadi. Number one, that Tehreek-e-Jadeed plan, the 19 points of Tehreek-e-Jadeed, are exactly the antidote of the entire scheme of the Jews. You will be surprised to find out Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani had not read that book. He had completely no idea of what the plan was. But Tehreek-e-Jadeed is the only counter and the only message of freedom, only hope of freedom and liberty from their designs and clutches. If you follow that program, they will lose all their charm and power. And the second, much more significant fact is this, that this book was brought to the notice of the English-speaking world in 1905. The first ever translation made of this book was in 1905. And in 1905, Hazrat Masih Maud was revealed from Allah that Freemason musallat nahi kiye jayenge. Now this is a book which claims that Freemason musallat kiye jayenge. That ultimately the Freemasons will capture the entire world, and the entire world will go under their clutches, and through them we will rule them. And Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has not the slightest idea what is happening elsewhere. That book was not even known to the to Indian and Pakistanis until recently. Only recently it was given publicity enough so that everybody started, not everybody, some people began to talk of this book. In those days in Qadian in 1905, Allah tells Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam that Freemason musallat nahi kiye jayenge. Nobody knew the significance at that time. What is happening? Why Freemason musallat nahi kiye jayenge? Who is thinking or planning capturing the entire world through the agency of Freemasons and so on? And this revelation, in fact, is the only hope for the world. And this revelation is a message to Ahmadiyyat that you will be the only cause of liberation of the rest of the world from this heinous plan of the Jewish people through the instrument of Freemasonry. Because nobody else was told this. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam was told that musallat nahi kiye jayenge. That means it was a glad tiding to Ahmadis that you don't have to fear from Freemasons. We have given you a program of liberty and freedom which cannot be frustrated by any worldly planners or things. Yes, please.
I just wanted to add in this connection that during recent revolution in Iran, one of the Freemasons' office was occupied by the public.
By?
By the people.
By the government.
By the government. And it was found that most of the people or the influential people heading the oil company or the other organizations and ministers in the governments were all members of the Freemason. And similarly, as Hazur has said, the categories in them, even the building or the office which was existing there, some of the rooms were never known to the higher board of directors which were sitting there. And this was all secret from one stage to another. And maybe this was just...
But still, that is just the apparent organization, known, the only organization known to the world. But behind that there are 29 tiers. And they would grow another Freemasonry immediately. I mean, everything is hidden.
From even the people
worldly people do not know. But the guarantee given to us is by God, who knows all that is hidden.
Quite true.
So we are the only people who are safe. The rest cannot claim, and it's impossible for them to get out of their clutches. Because to them, the danger is unknown. They don't know where it will come from and how it is going to be organized and planned ultimately. But the only people in the world who have been given this guarantee of liberation from Freemasonry are Ahmadis. And that was disclosed in 1905. So fantastic that one single revelation of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam should suffice to prove his truth. Because no explanation can be given for this one single line revelation, Freemason musallat nahi kiye jayenge. And what coincidence it is that the same is the year when this book is being published, which discloses the design of the Freemasons. I mean, this is not an ordinary accident. This is a design by Allah. Now, unfortunately, the entire Arab world is now completely under the clutches of Freemasonry. They are fighting the cause of the Arab cause against the Jews, and the entire Arab world has gone Freemason now, because there is hardly a man worth a song in Arab countries which has not either covert or overt connections with Freemasonry. And when I made inquiries from certain friends, I wanted to warn the Arab world against Freemasonry. So he told me it is a lost cause already. You can't do a thing. Only they would turn against you more and more bitterly for telling the world what is happening. Because all the news media, all the government offices, all the parties, even the Muslim fundamentalists and the bureaucracy, everything has gone under the Freemasonry and nobody can uproot them. So you are, with the grace of Allah, you are the only people in the world today who have been promised by Allah that you would not go under Freemasonry. I would see to it that you don't